morning, church. Let's stand and sing together. We're going to sing about how awesome our God's love is. For he is jealous for me. He loves like a hurricane, and I am a tree, bending beneath the weight of his wind and mercy. When all of a sudden I am unaware of these afflictions eclipsed by glory, I realize just how beautiful you are and how great your affections are for me. Oh, how he loves us so. Oh, how he loves us. How he loves us so. His portion, and he is our prize. We're drawn to redemption by the grace in his eyes. If his grace is an ocean, we're all sinking. So heaven means earth like an unforeseen kiss, and my heart turns violently inside my chest.
Turns violently inside of my conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And worthy is the King who conquers the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Ask that you center us in today. Help us to hear your word. Help us to focus in. For from beginning to beginning and end to end, it will always be about you, Jesus, as we sing. Jesus, be the center of it all. Jesus, be the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus. Jesus, be the center of it all. Jesus at the center of it all. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters. Nothing center of my life. Jesus, be the center of my life. From beginning to the end, it will always be, it's always been you, Jesus. Jesus, nothing else matters. You're the center, and everything revolves around you, Jesus, you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center, it's all about you. It's all about you. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus, be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. Jesus be the center of this church. Jesus be the center of this church. And every knee will bow, and every tongue shall confess you, Jesus. 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 Oh, we sing to Jesus. Jesus. Lift your voice to Jesus. Jesus. From my heart to the heavens, Jesus be the center. It's all about you. Yes, it's all about you. Jesus, oh, we sing to Jesus. Jesus, lift your voice to Jesus.
Jesus,
give your praise to Jesus. Jesus, oh, we sing to Jesus. Jesus.
Hi, I'm Tracy, and you're watching The Wave. Today's Globe offering supports the Benton Harbor Emergency Shelter, whose mission is to provide temporary housing for families and single parents with children and assist these families in finding permanent homes. Our community is working together to prevent and end homelessness in Berrien County. The United Methodist Women invite all women of the Water's Edge community to their monthly meeting on Tuesday, March 8th at 12 p.m. in the Commons. Be sure to bring a sack lunch and ideas for the missions and fellowship for the year ahead. Daylight Savings Time begins next Sunday, March 13th. Don't forget to spring ahead 1 hour. You're invited to an evening of reflection as we meet for a Good Friday remembrance on March 25th at 7 p.m. We'll gather around the fire pits in the outdoor patio and hear the story of Jesus' final days before his crucifixion. Come to hear, come to reflect, come to share. Come and celebrate the resurrection of our Savior at this year's Easter celebration. We'll celebrate with a devotional sunrise service at 7:30 a.m. and then gather for two identical worship services at 9 and 11 a.m. This is a celebration for all, so come and give praise to the one who has given new life beyond the cross. Following our worship services on Easter Sunday, March 27th, we'll be hosting a new weekly worship schedule at Water's Edge. Come to the blended worship service at 9 a.m. or the contemporary worship service at 11 a.m. To find out more about the worship services here at Water's Edge, head over to our website. All right, so let's recap for just a moment. Support today's Globe offering for the Benton Harbor Emergency Shelter. All women are invited to the United Methodist Women meeting on March 8th at 12 p.m. Don't forget to set your clocks ahead next week. Our Good Friday service will be on March 25th at 7 p.m. Plan to attend worship service on Easter morning at 9 or 11, and our newly worship schedule will be launched the Sunday after Easter with our blended service at 9 and contemporary service at 11. For more information about connecting into the Water's Edge community, check us out at h2oedge.org or on Facebook. And may God take you to the edge.
Good morning. It's really good to see each of you here today. I'm glad you're here. I think all of us are here today, keeping a divine appointment to learn and grow and connect with God. So I'm I'm grateful for your presence. I want to share a story this morning about a guy, and he's one of those persons you probably have never heard of, and yet his story has touched yours. He was born cross-eyed. I mean, severely cross-eyed his whole life. He had an incredibly weak chin, you know, soft, receding chin. And by the time he was 16, his hairline had receded to, you know, about here. If you were looking to typecast a TV evangelist, this is not the first person you would go for. And yet, this man, his name is George Whitfield, had an amazing life. A life that sparked revival in others because he himself first experienced revival. He attended Oxford University in England about the same time as John and Charles Wesley. If you've been with us the past few weeks, you know we've been looking at the lives of John and Charles Wesley and the foundations of our Methodist movement, and what it can teach us about being revived individuals and part of a revived church. So George Whitfield became one of their friends. And if you recall from previous weeks, John and Charles founded a group called the Holy Club. And in this Holy Club, George Whitfield attended. They would meet together, pray regularly. They would share in communion on a weekly basis. They would do all of those elements of developing their personal sense of holiness as well as caring for the larger world. George Whitfield was a man from childhood on up who struggled with chronic illnesses, most often nothing too severe, but every once in a while, something really significant. When John and Charles Wesley headed off in the 1730s to begin serving in the American colonies in Savannah, Whitfield took over as the leader of the Holy Club at Oxford. That is, until he became very ill, one of the most severe illnesses of his life. And it was during that illness that he started to really come to terms with the fact that just like John Wesley, just like his brother Charles, he had done the outward experiences and activities that you would think would be part of a holy life, but he had never integrated them into his soul, that he was still an unconverted person. Finally, uncertain of even his own personal survival, Whitfield had what we these days would call a deathbed conversion, and he cried out to God for salvation. Whitfield discovered the thing that we talked about last week. The true revival happens when we realize what God does for us. Not what we ourselves do. We can do all the activities of a faithful religious life. But if we haven't connected with God, they don't do the transformative work they can do. He now has that experience. Whitfield has a personal revival. From this week until we meet on Easter Sunday, we're going to look at the revived church, primarily through the eyes of the Wesley brothers, particularly John, but also through George Whitfield. Because he's a really good place to start when you want to see how one person's individual sense of revival can transform the world. I mentioned earlier, he wasn't the best-looking guy, he wasn't the healthiest guy. No one would call him handsome. And yet, after recovering from his illness, he went on to follow in John Wesley's footsteps, and he became a priest in the Church of England. In 1738, he took up the parish in Savannah, Georgia. Some of you know the story of that parish. It was John Wesley's until he abandoned it and went back to England in, well, let's be honest, disgrace at that point in his life. That's right. Whitfield took over Wesley's old post, and within a few months, the congregation just fell in love with their new pastor. His preaching was magnificent. His oratory was just beautiful. And he looked around Savannah, and he saw that here was a rough and tumble town. A lot of us don't know this, but in its origin, a high number of the original settlers of Georgia were like the original settlers of Australia. They were criminals taken out of English jails. There was a rough community there. And to add on top of that, there was a high number of orphans in the area. Not because their parents had died, but because parents had simply chosen to have kids and not take up the responsibility of raising them. After being there about a half a year, Whitfield decided he was going to go back to England. He announces it to his congregation. They're crestfallen. But he says, it's just short time. I'm going to go there. I'm going to raise the money we need, and we're going to start an orphanage for the children of Savannah and address this need. He takes ship back to England. And he starts first in London and then in Oxford and in some of the other well-heeled parts of the English Empire. He starts to meet with people and try to raise money for his orphanage. Now, I can't sit here and tell you he got zero, nothing, zip. But what he got was pretty close to that. And so he headed back to a part of the country where he had a lot of acquaintances and where he knew a lot of people. Over in Wales, a poorer part of the country, Bristol, to be specific. Lots of mining goes on, coal mining in Bristol. And he took up a new concept. He started doing some open-air preaching. Now, we've seen open-air preaching in our culture, and we're kind of, it's not as common as it was, say, 50, 80 years ago, but we know what it's about. In those days, to take that step would get you marked as an enthusiast, which was a negative connotation, and it would pretty much guarantee you are going to get barred from all the nice places. But he started preaching in the open air to the miners as they came off work in Bristol. And that's where George Whitfield, the person who had proclaimed to God his need for God's grace, suddenly discovered God's true purpose for him. They came by the hundreds. They came by the thousands. Records tell us they came by the tens of thousands. In short order, two things happened. There was revival breaking out across Wales, heartland in Bristol. And secondly, the money he needed for the orphanage, like that. He wants to head back to the American colonies to take up his responsibilities, but he also knows that God is moving in Bristol and something needs to be done about it. And so he looks up his old friends, it's now 1740, John and Charles Wesley. And he implores John, take up this mission, this revival in Bristol. And Wesley at first is hesitant. He doesn't want to do that. He doesn't want to get marked as that kind of outdoor rabble-rousing preacher the way Whitfield does. But in the end, he relents. And the first of the great Methodist revivals in England happens when John starts preaching outdoors. Put it another way, you're in a Methodist church. You're participating today in what I like to call the Methodist movement. If George Whitfield hadn't influenced John Wesley and convinced him to go to that first revival and take it to explosive growth, then John and Charles literally would be a couple of small group leaders with a club at Oxford, and it probably would have never gotten beyond there. You're in this room today because of someone that most of us probably never heard of until I started talking a few moments ago. Whitfield goes back to the Americas. Comes back to Savannah, buys an old house, turns it into the orphanage, says we're not only going to give these kids someplace to sleep and food to eat, we're going to teach them a radical notion in its day, and yet something that took off. And people began to flock to hear him in church again, so much so that he couldn't fit everybody in church. And so Whitfield said, well, if it worked in Bristol, we'll try it here in Savannah. And people started coming by the hundreds and the thousands. And before too long, he started getting invitations. Could you come to Columbia in South Carolina and do this? Could you come to New York? Could you possibly find your way up to Philadelphia? And before too long, in the 1740s, Whitfield is going up and down through the American colonies preaching these outdoor revivals. And the colonies needed them. You see, the American colonies were not populated by, well, England's best and brightest. They were typically people who'd had the hard knocks life. And they came here for a fresh start. But the basic things, like, you know, civic responsibility, a faithfulness to religious fealty, all of those things were absent from their lives. It was a rough and tumble place, this American colonies in the 1740s. And along comes Whitfield, and he starts these preaching revivals, and then others take it up. And what happens, historians tell us, is called the First Great Awakening. He finds his way, for example, to Philadelphia. And there's a scholar and a scientist in that city in 1740 who is just amazed at Whitfield's preaching and the strength of his voice. And so he goes out and he does a little kind of calculation. And he goes to one of his revivals and he paces off how far he can walk away while still hearing the man. It's an incredible distance. And he measures it out, and then he gets a map out, and he puts Whitfield at the center, and he puts where he could still hear him, and he draws this big, enormous circle all around. You following me? And then he estimates the number of people who could be standing in that circle. He came up with 30,000 people. And here's the thing. There were more people than who could hear Whitfield that day. 30,000. This is the 1740s. And that scholar and scientist, you know, he also had a newspaper in Philadelphia. Maybe you've heard of him. His name was Ben Franklin. You probably have heard of him in another setting. Franklin wrote in his paper about Whitfield, and this is what he noted. He noted, the wonderful change soon made in the manners of our inhabitants. From being thoughtless or indifferent about religion, it seemed as if all the world was growing religious, so that one could not walk through the town in the evening without hearing psalms sung in different family homes of every street. Summer's coming. Go home some evening, take a walk, and listen to those psalms coming out of every family home along the street. Want to know what revival looks like? That's revival. And here's the last piece of it. This revival in religious faith, for many of them, it was the first religious faith of their lives. It led to a renewed emphasis on education. Remember how he committed to educating the orphans? And it led to a renewed emphasis on civic matter. People started caring about their communities. And people started to care not only about their communities, but they started caring about the rights they had as citizens. Do you see where this is going? Concerned about their rights as citizens, we're now in the mid-1740s. That's right. This first great awakening, as it's called, was one of the cultural changes that created the environment in which the American Revolution was born. George Whitefield. We'd never heard of him. Sickly, weak chin, cross-eyed, unhandsomed by any measure that we would hold these days. And not only was he essential to the founding of this and thousands of places such as this and the long history and witness of the Methodist movement, he was essential to creating the culture for this nation. That's what revival does. It takes you from the person you are, who has a lot of potential, gets you right with God, gets you filled with the Holy Spirit, so that you can become the person who's no longer of potential, but who is now fully living out the purposes God has for you. That's what revival's always been. We see it not only in the life of George Whitefield, in the founding of the Methodist Church, in the Wesley brothers, in the great movements of the Spirit in our own history. Notice I called it the First Great Awakening. Right after the Civil War, there was a second one, even more profound. And I wonder how many of us these days are wondering and waiting and willing to pray for a third one. It happens throughout history. It happened in the city of Ephesus in biblical times. The church there had been founded by Paul. We understand that from the book of Acts. And he had actually labored there on one of his missionary journeys for two or three years, just with one church, trying to get them straight in their faith and so that they would fully understand what God was calling them to do. And he finally writes a letter to them. We have it in the New Testament. It's Ephesians, and I want to look today with you at chapter 2, verses 8 through 10. Now, these verses are actually, I think, fairly familiar. I bet a lot of us will say, I think I've heard this before. They're incredibly profound. I've known two or three souls in my life, personal relationships, who, when they understood the meaning of these scriptures, this was their moment of revival. And what Wesley is laying out for the people in Ephesus, who have a really nice life, it's a fairly wealthy community. They have a lot of comforts. They can take it easy in so many different ways. What he's laying out for them is that God has not called us to have the good life. God has called us to live for God's holy purposes. And he lays out what we just saw in the life of George Whitefield. Come to God, realize that it's God who saves you, not your own acts, not your own sense of piety, not your own sense of holiness. And then the purposes that God had created you for, that were always there, can now be lived out in full. Let's look at it, and I'll read it and listen together, and I think you'll see it. Paul writing to the Ephesians. For by grace you have been saved through faith. God's grace, your response, Whitefield's cry, our acknowledgement that we need God, however you frame it, that's your act of faith, but it's God's first act in Christ that's grace. And this is not your own doing. It is a gift of God, not the results of works. You can do all that personal, pious stuff. It's got a value. We're going to talk about that in a moment, but it doesn't get you there. So that no one may boast, for we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. Yeah, we're called to do good things in this world, not to save our souls, but so that we can live into the purpose God has for us. George Whitfield, as sickly and as hurting, and as much as he struggled as a young person, when he finally made that connection and had a revived heart, then he lived into God's purposes that transformed the world. I wonder if that could happen today. I wonder if we ask God into our hearts, might we become a people who start really living out the purposes God has for us? And if one life, whether it's Paul among the Ephesians and everybody else, or Whitfield and what he did, if one life can have the kind of change that we see there, imagine what the 60, 70, maybe 80 lives, the impact they could have from just this room. So I want to ask you to do some homework today. I'm going to ask you to do some of the things that Whitfield did. Do some of the things that John and Charles Wesley did. Some of these acts of personal piety, not to earn your salvation, but because by taking up these acts, you can be in relationship with God until you become fully blossomed into the person God intended you to be. So here are Wesley's four acts of personal piety that he said. He had actually more, but these are the four he hung his hat on. And I'm going to walk you through them quickly, and then I'm going to give you your homework. The first one, he said, is prayer. Everything starts with relationship with God. How's your relationship with God? When was the last time you talked? Was it the last time you had a meal and you said, "For this food, we give you thanks, amen"? I mean, did you even know you were talking to somebody who was listening when you said that? I've got a way to help you pray this week that'll be a part of your homework. Second, healthy living. For Wesley, he kept the ancient fast on Wednesdays and Fridays of not eating until the middle of the day. In a broader sense, he was concerned about people's health. As some of you who are in my Monday class know, he actually wrote a book about personal well-being and health. Part of your homework this week isn't going to be about physical activity so much as it is about getting our spiritual health right. The third one is regular participation in worship / communion. The reason why it's there every week is because the founder of our movement had it there every week, because he knew the power of that table, that bread, that cup to change lives. Are you participating? I think revival starts there. And it's not just about showing up when you show up and having communion then. It's about showing up more faithfully. Do you know that the number of people who go to church these days is roughly the same number that was around 40 or 80 years ago? And you may say, "Wait, Pastor, I hear church attendance is going down." You're right, it is. You know what the number one cause is? People used to come three or four times a month. Now they come once or twice. Wesley's challenge for the holy life wasn't for once or twice a month. And then finally, the fourth one. Are you meditating on the scriptures? Are you reading them? Do you know where your Bible is at home? Is it up on some shelf? Do you need to pull it down off the top shelf to some place where it's handy? Is it in that box where, you know, of things that you've never gotten around to unpacking from the last time you moved? Is it one of those Bibles that's sitting on the on the table in the den in a prominent place so people can see it, but you know, you never think to pick it up. Is it the app that you got put on your phone so long ago and you said, this is great, and you used it once or twice and you don't even update it anymore? Read the Word. And that's part of your homework too. So here it is. Starting tomorrow, I would like us to read some prayers from the Bible together. You can mark these down, you can put them on your phone, you can remember it when you leave. They're Psalms, and there are 6 of them. Tomorrow, read Psalm 18. On Tuesday, read 19. On Wednesday, read 20. On Thursday, 21. On Friday, 22. On Saturday, 23. 18 through 23, 6 days. That's our homework. It's a prayer. It's Bible reading. It'll lead to you thinking about your spiritual health, and we're going to share in that bread and cup this week and next and every week as a foundation for all of this. Read those scriptures. See how God describes the victory he wants to bring to his people. See how God describes that you have a purpose in this world. See how God describes next Friday what God is willing to do, what lengths God is willing to go to so that you'll grab hold of your purpose. And next Saturday, read that famous 23rd Psalm and see how, yes, every one of us goes inevitably into the darkness that is in this world and that is in the grave, but that none of us are alone. And then come back next Sunday. Come back a little early or stay a little late and walk up to the first person you meet and say, you know, I read my scriptures and here's what I experienced about God, about the church, and about myself. Come up to me and tell me. And let's just spend next week talking about how amazing the God of our lives, of our hearts, of our revived souls truly is. Amen. Would you pray with me? Oh Lord, our God, you have been a blessing from generation to generation. Thank you for being the blessing in the age of Wesley and Whitfield. Thank you for when a soul cries out to you, that you can take hold of that soul and say, see the purpose you can now fulfill. See what I have laid out before you. Thank you, Lord, for the saints who have gone before us, who have brought us to this divine appointment today with a nudge here and a gentle push there, or a drive of a car, or the sharing of a scripture, or the holding of a hand, or a joint prayer together. And now, Lord, for some of us, this is the first time. We ask that you be in our hearts today. And for some of us, we've done it before, and you're still there, but maybe we have cooled. Maybe we have chilled. And we need the fire of your Spirit in renewed ways. Lord, if we have been less than you have called us to be, forgive us. If there have been ways that we have not lived by your faith, but lived by our own agenda, if there have been sins that are scarlet, wash them clean by your presence. Lord, in these quiet moments, Lord, hear our prayer. Now, with your mercy and grace poured out to us as a repentant people, may your forgiveness wash through us and anoint us with grace. And in grace and through grace and by grace, O Lord, we give ourselves to you so that we might be the ones who live by your purpose, so that your reign in Christ, your kingdom will come, not by our handiwork, but by your presence through us, until that day comes when it's here in its fullness and all the world sings your glory. The glory we now name in the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Grace unending grace. begin our week, realize what God has done for you. Experience God's grace. And may God take you to the edge this week.